Thank you, Sanjeev ji, for your very kind words of introduction. I must say, quite exaggerated, but very warm, and I thank you for that, and request all the other participants to discount it by 90%. Of course, I'm not promoting e-commerce here so that there's no fear of predatory pricing. Mr. Vikash Agarwal, Senior Vice President of the Indian Chamber of Commerce. I see a lot of other friends on the call, Mr. Gaurav Swarup, Rudra Chatterjee, many other friends who have taken the time to join us. Mr. Rajiv Singh, somebody with whom I've had the pleasure of interacting on several occasions all through the pandemic. And I remember actually Mayank and Rajiv almost embarrassed me one day while recounting that they had had some 26 or 27 interactions, and that was 3 months ago. And I was wondering whether I'm on some wrong path. Am I taking too much of your valuable time through my various video interactions? But I must acknowledge the very, very important role that the Indian Chamber of Commerce has played in our own humble efforts to tide over the COVID-19 pandemic period to ensure an orderly handling of the entire crisis and recovery back to the pre-COVID levels, and then back to our original agenda of achieving a $5 trillion economy. All the distinguished members of ICC deserve the highest praise for the good work this chamber has done over 95 years. It's a long 95-year glorious history. I'm given to understand ICC even played a very important role in promoting Indian entrepreneurs in the pre-independence days. That's something to be truly proud of. And in some sense, I think COVID has helped the nation recognize ICC and their huge number of engagements through VC. Have helped us in government understand the huge value that chambers who may not be headquartered in Delhi, but who have a huge say and a huge presence in industry, in trade, in exports, foreign engagements, who are outside this, in Prime Minister's famous words, Lutyens' environment. But actually have a very, very important contribution to the nation's economic development. I must thank you, Mayank, for your own personal and very active, very youthful and energetic role in helping us through the COVID period. Your ideas are always quite innovative, to the point, very well presented. And I'm sure after you lay down your office, you will continue your engagement, just like Sanjeev continues to give leadership to ICC. You will continue to remain engaged. Vikash, I believe you will be taking over. My warmest wishes to you.
Thank you, sir.
You have big shoes to fill,
Absolutely, sir.
right from the good old days of Sanjeev and other illustrious presidents up to Mayank. And I have no doubt in my mind that you will be equally successful and hold the flag of ICC high.
Thank you so much, sir.
Mahatma Gandhi ji had once said, and I quote, "Strength does not come from physical capacity. It comes from an indomitable will." And I think the people of India have demonstrated to the world that indomitable spirit, that resilience that Indian business, the people of India have in facing adversity and finding opportunity even in a crisis. today, as many other parts of the world are still grappling with this crisis, and you know what's happening in America, you know what's happening almost across Europe. London is the latest to decide a very strict lockdown starting tomorrow. In this period, our own performance in tackling this crisis with a near 95% recovery rate, a mortality rate of less than 1.5%, the economy recovering very sharply in a sharp V, which I hope will then become a tick mark going all the way up and bring back that excitement, that mojo that all of us Indian businessmen are known for around the world. Of course, the Kolkata businessmen, even more so. It's an opportunity for us to really relook at our own businesses, our processes, our way of working, relook at our quality and productivity standards, look at costs and cost efficiencies. I am sure, since I see so many big names from industry on the screen before me, each one of us has seen adversity, has seen bad times in our industry. Each one of us has gone through serious troubles. But every time we went into trouble, I don't think any of you ever gave up, or you wouldn't have been here on the call today. Each one of you looked at solutions. Each one of you looked at tightening your belt to become more efficient, to deliver customer satisfaction, to meet the larger objectives of your business or your industry. And God also helps, as they say, only those who help themselves. And I believe today, this steely resolve, particularly of industry, to adapt itself to the new normal, to change, to the new way of life, the new way of doing business, is going to hold all of you and us in good stead in the days and years to come. I still remember in the initial period when the lockdown was announced, there were enough voices, particularly of some leaders who never grow up. And I don't mean it in a bad sense. It's just that some leaders, despite passing of time, are always called youth leaders. I don't know how, but I was only looking at age. I was not talking about growing up in terms of maturity or understanding. So please don't misunderstand me. But some leaders who seem to never grow up have questioned India's lockdown. It amazes me at the ignorance in understanding that a nation starved of adequate healthcare facilities, where COVID protocols were not even known to anybody, save and except maybe an AIIMS in Delhi and possibly Dr. Naresh Trehan at Medanta, who had quickly adapted to the new COVID protocols. A nation which had one testing center in Pune to do 250 tests a day. A nation of 135 crore Indians, by the way. On the day of the lockdown, I don't know if you remember, we had only 4 testing centers with a total capacity of 2,500 tests a day. We had inadequate ventilators. We were concerned about oxygen supply should there be a massive outbreak. Of course, personal protective equipment, masks, these were things that India never produced. Masks were being produced more for export than Indian use, except the little bit used in the hospitals. PPEs, we were only dependent on imports. Our total stock of PPEs on 25th of March were barely a few thousand. And I remember Dr. Trehan telling me that day that he used to use 6 personal protective equipment PPEs, 6 per COVID patient. in the initial period when the fear psychosis was really huge. And he said our stocks will not last us maybe 3 or 4 days. And the situation was so dangerous that you could have possibly witnessed what we saw in some very developed European countries, where people were not even willing to give a respectful burial or funeral to their near and dear ones affected by COVID, possibly affected fatally in some cases. Nobody was willing to touch that person and were literally throwing them out of the house and leaving them on the streets. India did not see a single such instance, despite our very low preparedness levels and our developing country status, our low per capita incomes, our inadequacies in the healthcare sector for lack of adequate investment over nearly 70, 73 years post-independence. We used the lockdown to break the coronavirus chain. We quickly ramped up our efforts to import PPEs and other such required equipment like ventilators and stuff like that. I don't know if Sanjeev ji remembers my call with all the business leaders of India. And we were appealing to them, use every source you have across the world, but pick up any stock of PPEs, ventilators that you can get, testing kits. We didn't have testing kits in India. So somebody with the symptoms also could not be tested for lack of adequate machines and testing kits. And I remember, despite the best efforts of the top industry houses, we were not able to get equipment from anywhere because everybody was holding back for their own needs. Some equipment came, which was of very poor quality. And that is when Prime Minister Modi made this appeal to Indian industry and Indian business to rise to the occasion. And I can tell all of you, this nation is proud of each and every one of you. And this nation will always remember the way Indian industry rose to the occasion, the way Indian industry expanded capacities, did R&D to start manufacturing PPEs in India, to ramp up mask manufacturing for domestic use, started manufacturing ventilators in huge quantities within the country. How many people may not have been successful end of the day, but literally went to the drawing board to start designing ventilators, using automobile machines to use and try and create ventilator capacity. And I tell you, our doctors, our frontline healthcare professionals, nurses, paramedic staff, our security staff, police, paramilitary forces, in the middle of all of this, we had to contend with problem on our borders, our armed forces. If I may mention, though it's a ministry under me, but the railway services across this period, throughout this period, A, moving freight so that throughout the country, you would not have heard a single instance of shortage of essentials or food grains, or even fertilizer for our farmer or coal for the coal plants, for the power plants. Steel mills were allowed to function as continuous process industry. They needed coal, they needed iron ore, they needed to move their finished products. The Shramik specials were taken out to help our migrant labor go back to their homes. The railway officials, railway workmen also have families. They could have also have said, look, I'm not risking my life. I'm also going to work from home. But I promise you, from the 23rd of March until today, from the Janta curfew day until today, I do not have one railway official or workman, and I say this with authority, not one person who refused to carry out his duties demanded of him during this period. And therefore, this nation owes a debt of gratitude to all our corona warriors, to all these different people, the sanitation workers, government officials, who kept the wheels of the economy running to the best of the current situation then prevailing, to our services sector, who made India proud by ensuring that all our services customers across the world were served. Our exports on services were at the level of 90% plus through the lockdown, quickly moving machinery to their homes, computers, calling center equipment, all of that, but making sure we did not let down a single customer. That's the true strength of India. That is an Indian businessman, an Indian entrepreneur, an Indian youth, and the power of India. Ladies and gentlemen, today is the time where the world is looking upon India as a trusted partner. The world is wanting resilient global supply chains. If we don't grab this opportunity today, posterity will never, never, ever forgive us. It is our duty, each one of us, to take this opportunity, make Atmanirbhar Bharat our mantra, our inspiration, our goal. And by Atmanirbhar Bharat, we are not closing our engagement with the rest of the world. We are, on the contrary, expanding our engagement. We should import modern technology, import modern equipment which can help us do the job better, which can help us produce to scale, better quality, better productivity standards, cost competitive manufacturing in India. Bring in what is best done outside the world and can be imported. But leverage all that and leverage our millions of skilled young boys and girls to become the factory of the world, just like we are today recognized as the pharmacy of the world. And ladies and gentlemen, I can assure you full support, not only of the government of India, but all the state governments and local bodies. We'll all work as one. We'll all work as a team. Industry and government have to partner to truly ensure that we reach our $5 trillion target by 2025, $10 trillion target, maybe another 7 years after that, 8 years maybe. But ultimately, I would think the vision of this country, the needs of 1.35 billion people, the capabilities of our businessmen, our entrepreneurs, our startups, our young boys and girls, our skilled manpower, have the ability to become the world's number one economy, maybe in 25 years, maybe in 30. But the challenge is for us to accept. When we celebrate 100 years of independence in 2047, can we all not resolve to be the number one economy in the world? I believe can give the people-centric policies, the positive outlook that you and I share, the proactive action that Prime Minister Narendra Modi has demonstrated over his 6 years in office, both for a better life for our poor, for the marginalized sections of society, and to encourage honest business in this country. I think collectively, government, industry and business, our teachers, our universities, all sections of India working as a team, working as Team India, can ensure a prosperous future for each and every individual in this country, and certainly sustainable development, which is the goal of this government, can lead us to transformation like never before. I believe it is enjoined upon all of us to ensure we leave behind a better world than the one we inherited. As they say, we have enough to meet everybody's need, maybe not enough to meet everybody's greed. Let us all work to ensure that we can meet the needs of 135 crore Indians, the needs for good quality healthcare, good education, decent life, good home, work and job opportunity, scale up Indian manufacturing to the 25% level that we have all committed, expand our international engagement, and together we can certainly, working in collaboration, working in cooperation with each other, make sure that the new age India, the new India of tomorrow, will become owner's pride and neighbor's. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.